history, yes? Well, good evening, blessed be. I am Jeff Magnus, McBride from Las Vegas. And tonight we're going to see the very best magic that I've collected from all over the world. You'll see dramatic magic, comedy magic, ritual magic, and my specialty, the world's most difficult form of magic, pure sleight of hand magic. Are you ready for some of that? We'll get the show started. We'll go change up. Go to track two, Regis, for some sleight of hand magic. Music. Just check it. Watch. Now, I never worked with audience setups, but I saw a woman beautifully dressed like a belly dancer in the audience. Never really met her. Would you make your way to the stage? See, one of the things that you may not know is when I'm not performing in Las Vegas, I actually run the world's only magic school for professional magicians. It's called McBride's Magic and Mystery School, and this is our latest initiate. This is Holly, ladies and gentlemen. Holly. Well, welcome to our mystery school. It's kind of like Harry Potter, but for grown-ups. Right over here. And ladies can be professional magicians, too. All you have to do is follow my instructions. Hold that. So it adds to the show. You see that every day? That's more like it. Here we go. Now, one of the things that I truly believe, that each and every one of us is a magician. I'm just here to remind you that each one of us has the power to transform our reality. Now, we've never made magic before, especially on stage, and now it is your turn. Take that with your right hand, take the other end with your left hand, right here, and slowly pull the knot tight. Tighter, tighter, tighter. Let go of your right hand. Move it up. You can do it. You can. How did that feel? It's amazing. Wait a minute. Well, you know, in the art of magic, there's a price to pay for everything. A round of applause. applause for Holly. You were wonderful. Applause! So, yeah. Oh, one of my fans when I need them. Here we go. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Now, interestingly enough, I did start magic just by performing magic tricks. And when I was in Las Vegas in my mid-20s, I reached a place of real dissatisfaction. And I started studying, well, to find real magic. And I started to read books on ceremonial magic and shamanism. And I put together what I felt was an act that was based in mythology and symbolism. And I wanted to put it to the acid test. So what I did is I went and studied with the masters. The earliest magicians, of course, as we know, are ancient shaman and sorcerers who work with the magical elements to unlock the mysteries of the universe, the mysteries of earth, air, fire, and water. Thank you. take a good look at those balls, make sure that they're perfectly normal. Everybody always wants to examine the water balls. And we'll take the next piece of music there, Regis. Yes? Are they perfectly normal?
Say so, sir.
Perfectly normal?
What?
Perfectly normal?
As normal as I am.
And this guy's pretty normal. You saw him up here, right? Thank you very much. A round of applause for my examination committee. You're good. So to continue the story, we'll bring that level down a little bit. I take my magic act, my kind of elemental magic act, to a gathering that I hear about called Rites of Spring. So I'm a little bit dissatisfied with the state of the art of magic, and I think by injecting some meaning into the magic, I'll get more personal satisfaction out of it, and maybe my audience will relate to the magic in a deeper way. So I'm a little bit nervous to see what all of these pagans at this pagan gathering Rites of Spring are going to think about me mixing stage magic with ritual magic. And I'm at the feast there, and I meet this rather tall, large man with a huge voice named Ian Corrigan. And I say, I'd like to show you my elemental magic act to see what you think. And he says, well, go right ahead, Magnus. And I'm a little bit nervous because I've never been around, you know, all these ritual magicians and druids before. And I do my that piece, the invocation of water. And he looks at me and he laughs. He goes, ha, ha, ha. In all the years I've been coming to these things, Magnus, we've never had a real magician before. And I felt like I was home ever since. Yeah. So he says, you know, we put on Starwood. Well, not quite of a pirate voice, but more of a Gaelic thing he puts on. But he invited me to start. Took me a couple of years to get here, but I did indeed get here. And I'm so glad I did. And what I've heard about this particular Starwood, by a round of applause and screams, how many people are experiencing your first Starwood? That's pretty great. And what I heard is, I think officially, that this is the largest crowd count that they ever had at a Wisteria Starwood. Is that right? Means it's catching on. Even the young folks are hearing about it. Remember, kids, before Burning Man, there was Starwood. Before drums and crystals, there was Starwood. Ooh. Do you remember that when you go online? Tell your friends to come. Yeah, burn. It's called bonfire.
Yeah.
Yeah. We know how to do it. But, so I started studying different currents of magic, and one of the shaman that really impressed me was a shaman named Black Elk. And Black Elk was famous for having the vision of the sacred hoops. And in Black Elk's vision, he saw all the different nations of the world symbolized by giant hoops. And these hoops were joining together in one great unbreakable chain. Now, even though Black Elk's vision of the sacred hoops uniting is many years old, I think it's a very important message to pass on to the generations of today. So I tracked down a Native American shaman named Wilbur Two Eagles. He taught me some of the moves from the hoop dance, and I taught him some magic, and we kind of cross-pollinated our showman and shaman skill sets. So I guess this is shamanism in a weird way, you know? I made up that word just for you, okay? Yeah. So this is the hoop dance of Black Elk. Music, Regis. Okay, we have the four hoops that represent the four directions, the four nations, the four elements. That's two. That's three. That's four. Here we go. right here. Would you stand up and examine these? I'll hold them right there for you. You two. You two guys. Both of you guys stand up. Yeah. Take both of them. Examine them to make sure that they're perfectly solid. You take that one right there. And you take that one. Examine it. Make sure that they're perfectly solid. See, the magicians never pass out all the rings. Are they perfectly solid? Yes? Okay, I'll take this one and I'll wait for yours. Here we go. Okay. Show where we get to send two people back in time. Any time travelers out there? I'm looking at this man here. I think his name is Jack and his partner. Would you make his way to the stage? Make your way to the stage. It keeps me from coming all the way out there. Now, it's interesting that magic and our mind give us the capacity to travel through time, and that's just about what we're going to be doing for the next part of the show. We're going to be stepping back in time to Renaissance Italy for some street magic. It's curious. Thank you. You're right over here. You're right over here, and the gentleman right over here. Now remember, in my show, I never said anything. You're just as surprised as anybody else, aren't you? I know. It's curious that one of the most ancient forms of magic in the world, street magic, is one of the most popular forms of magic today. Now, the magicians used to dress like street merchants, kind of like they would wear pouches, because many of them were indeed merchants that would use juggling and magic skills to attract their crowds. And today, with your help, oh, there it is, I got it, thank you, that was good. We're going to step back in time for some Renaissance street magic. Would you come up here just a little bit? And in order to do this, one of the reasons I called you, I think this is going to go great with your outfit. Indeed. This is the paper mystery, ladies and gentlemen, because it uses paper. If it was the frog mystery, I would use frogs, but frogs are much harder to tear. Here you go. Now take one piece in each hand and give it a tear and tear it again. Yep, both of them. Very good. Now I'll take your pieces, or your torn pieces, and place at your right hand. Place at your right hand. Very good. Now, the interesting thing here is I'm going to teach you a magical formula. And the magical formula is abracadabra. And most people don't know that it means it is created as it is spoken. We create as we speak. So say abracadabra.
Abracadabra.
That was perfect.
Yeah, yeah.
it. Open your hands. Oh, well, it looks like a little Renaissance bonnet for you, my dear. Huzzah! May I? Yes, that looks great. Well, isn't that cool? You have the only one that's... What are you laughing at? Darn thing. Place it right by... Oh, you're taking a good look at it. Okay, place it on. Okay, place it on. Take one piece of paper in each hand, show the pieces of paper, tear them in half, and then tear them in half again. Okay, and I'll take the pieces and place out your left hand. Two hands. And say, abracadabra. Open your hands. Did you say abra viagra? What did you say? Oh, look at this. Look at this. Like it looks like a little Renaissance jester's hat for you, my lord. There we go. Huzzah! Okay. There we go. Okay, it's hard to put on that chia kind of thing. Step back a little bit. Okay, now we are almost ready to step back in time for some Renaissance street magic. Could you give us the next piece of music, maestro? Thank you. And bring it kind of down to background music. To transport us back in time, we have a commedia dell'arte mask. This is the type of mask that was worn during the Renaissance by street performers, and they're still worn in the world today. His name is Bravo. To wake him up, you say Bravo.
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 Now, he's a little naughty. He's a little bawdy, as the characters were back in those days. He's going to take over. And I'll be back in just a few minutes, okay? Okay, buonanotte, we have some nice people here for some nice street magic. Ciao, bella. Hey, bravo!
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 Very, very good. We have some nice people. You like magic?
Oh, yeah.
Very good. And you like magic?
Yeah.
Very good. Come over here. It's very nice. Is everything good?
Yeah.
And is anything wrong?
No.
Okay, it's good. And you like him?
Oh, yeah.
Ah, very good. And what is your name?
Igor.
Very good. And what is your name?
Susie.
Very good. And you like a magic?
Oh, yeah.
Well, wave hello to the audience.
Hello.
Okay, very nice. Step over here.
Yeah.
Okay, here.
Okay.
Now watch. I have some very fresh magic all the way from Italy. Would you like to see it? Yes? Okay. Whoa. Oh, it's very fresh. Hey. It's my ball. Oh, yes, I know you like it. Place out your hand. Don't squeeze my ball. Okay, he likes it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, very nice. Okay, watch. Nothing in the bowl. Nothing. Watch. Nothing in the bowl. Watch the bowl. Hey, bravo! Bravo! Okay, watch, I do it again, watch. Nothing in the bowl. Watch the bowl. Hey, bravo! It's good, I know, watch. Very nice, watch the bowl. Okay, watch. Now watch the bowl. Don't squeeze my ball. Okay, you don't want to squeeze my... You can squeeze my ball.
Oh, yeah.
You like it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, watch. Watch. Nothing in the hand. Watch the bowl. Only one. Two hands. Squeeze tight. Don't move. Two hands. Don't move. Watch the bowl. Nothing impossible, incredible, huh? Slowly open. You like that? Okay, turn your head and cough. Oh, great, I'll watch now. Watch, nothing. Nothing in the bowl, grand finale. Watch, First of all, I take a ball. That's the number one. Watch your number two. A different way. Watch. Nothing in the hands. One, two, three. Hey, three balls. Yes. One, two, three. Finale. Hey. Hey, I got it. Three balls. My mother said I was a special. Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, bye-bye. Bye-bye. Oh, no. Oh no, oh no, oh no, problem, oh no, problem, oh no, problem, oh no, no problems. Everybody, drum roll. One, two, three. Oh, big fruit. Hey, Fiore, bravo! Bravo! I'm back, thank you. Thank you guys, you were great. A big round of applause.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
Okay, bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
You guys having a good time? Yeah. Wonderful. This is one of my favorite places to play. I haven't been to Wisteria in quite a few years, but one of the things I love coming here is doing the fire circles. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to host the Alchemical Fire Circle last night. By a round of applause, how many people attended that? Thank you. I'm sure we'll be back. I love doing it for the Wisteria crew, and I love doing it for the Starwood crew. And Abby Spinner sends her love. We're doing Illumination Gathering next week, week after next in Portland, Oregon. So she couldn't be here tonight because she's packing her costumes for that one. And, you know, somebody was asking me, how did I get into magic? And kids, I got into magic by reading books when I was about 8 years old. Just by reading books. And by the time I was 16, I had the extraordinary opportunity to travel to Japan, all the way to Japan to study magic, martial arts, and Japanese kabuki theater, which is the ritual theater of Japan. And when I returned to the USA, I took all of these different theatrical disciplines and I combined them to create my own unique fusion of theatrical magic, which will now transport us to our next destination, the mysterious land of the rising sun, Japan. Music? And lock your fingers tightly together. Hold your hands up a little bit further and lock your thumbs together. Do not open your fingers. Do not turn your hands inside out. Slowly twist your thumbs as far as they'll go to the side. Feel that stretch. Do not turn your hands inside out. Do exactly what I do, and no one will get hurt. This next move will separate the mystics from the muggles. Here we go. Slowly turn your thumbs until your thumbs are pointing straight up and relax. How are we doing out there? Look like a whole field of human pretzels. Give yourselves a round of applause. I told you it was a secret technique. Gentlemen, come over here. You're going to be over here, and you're going to be on the other side. And your name?
Mason.
Mason?
Jason.
Mason and Jason. I do know how to pick a Mason. Now, you guys are going to be the committee for the audience. You guys are the ears, the hands, the eyes of the audience. And Mason, this is the end for you. No, this is the end for you. Okay. This is the end for you. I want you to pull on that to make sure it's very solid. Okay, guys, let go of the rope just for a second. To butch it up here a little bit. There's all these hot ladies out here. Now, what you gotta do is imagine the strongest muscle builder pose that you've ever seen. Have you locked it into your imagination? Yes? Mason, the count of three, I want you to hit that muscle builder pose. One, two, three, hit the pose. That's more like it, guys. That's good. Okay. And also we have the shroud, but in just a moment, can you see without your glasses, Mason? Then why do you wear them? Okay, here we go. I'm going to place them in a padded pocket where they can't get hurt, and I'm going to hand you this. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Shroud of Mystery. The Shroud of Mystery. Okay, this goes in that far hand,
And there are three, the far hand, this club has three positions. The first position is neck. The second position is top of head. And the third position, I'm going to say, throw it to the floor. And you throw it to the floor, you'll pick it up by the knot, okay? Mm. We'll take the rope. You guys are going to do the tying here. Take the rope. And I want you to pull that steadily and pull it tight. Very good. Very good. And I want you to put a finger here and put another knot right on top. Now make sure it's very tight. Good. Keep going. Very good. Excellent. And not only are they skilled, ladies and gentlemen, relax a little bit. They have smiles like male models. Flash that grin, okay? Tie another knot right on top of my wrists. Right on top of my wrists. Work together. Okay, yep, teamwork. Very good. And hold, yep, put another knot right on top of that. And one more knot right on top of that. Make sure it's really tight. Regis, let's loop this music. Let's start it again. Very good, gentlemen. Is that as tight as it can get? Good. Okay, now the shroud of mystery, ladies and gentlemen. Very good. Two hands. Bring it right to my, just to my neck. Now, do not look behind the shroud of mystery, gentlemen. Your eyes will burst into flames. Bring it right to the top of my head, all the way to the top of my head. Okay, very good, and flash those smiles. At the count of three, I want you to throw it all the way to the floor. One, two, three, throw it to the floor and check the knot. Okay, and you may maybe tie another knot on top of that, good. Mason, would you check, tie the knot? Would you check the knot? Those are Masons, ladies and gentlemen. I think you need them more than I am. You couldn't see him. Okay, let's bring the cloth up again, the shroud of mystery, right up to my chin. Right, just to my chin. Now, the important thing is you have to smile. You have to look forward and smile. Because in just a few seconds, I am going to try to get out of this, okay? It's important you look ahead and big smile. Show the team. That's the important thing. Gentlemen, throw it to the floor. One, two, three. Check the knot! That was fast!
Yeah.
Check the knot. Make sure it's really tied tightly. You too, really check it. We're going to do this one more time. Bring it right up to my neck. The important thing is that you look forward, okay? Now, this has to be done fast. At the count of three, you're going to throw it to the floor as fast as you can. One, two, three, throw it to the floor. That was even faster! Check the knot. Make sure it's a real knot. Make sure those hands are tight. Okay, this is the audience participation part of the show. Bring it right up to my neck, and you're going to count backwards from 10. Can you do that loudly? 10! 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. There it is! Okay, gentlemen, hit the pose. 1, 2, 3! Thank you guys, you were great. Round of applause for my two bondage boys. Woo! Can we go to the next piece of music, please? Oh, we're going to go to the next piece of music. Yep, the next piece of music. One of the things I love about festivals at Starwood is spending time at people's campsites, just sitting down with them, spending time between the worlds, just telling stories by the campfire. It's one of my favorite things to do. And sometimes I think that I work in Las Vegas just to underwrite my fire circle habit. Because I love this. If I had to do anything in the world, it would be going to festivals, sharing my magic with you, and lighting fires. So it's an honor to be here.
Yeah.
And I am very fortunate to be able to study with a really great wizard, and his name is Eugene Berger. And he's the world's foremost philosopher on the art of stage magic. And he says, one of the things that makes us human is our ability to tell stories. And we humans have been telling stories on this planet long before the time of recorded history. And this is one of my favorite stories. A single piece of rope. In the stories of India, it is the god Brahma who creates the world and all that there is. Brahma then retires, and the god Vishnu appears. And Vishnu sustains and preserves the universe in every moment of its existence. And then, at the end of time, Lord Shiva appears and dances the Tandava dance, a weird and terrible dance of fire in which the entire material universe is destroyed in blinding light, brighter than 10,000 suns. And the universe is no more. There is only silence, vast, cosmic sleep. And out of that sleep, Brahma awakens himself, and seeing nothing lovely, nothing beautiful, he decides to create the universe again. And in creating it, he retires, pleased with his eternal play. Thank you. You see, I live in Las Vegas, and Las Vegas has more light per square inch than anywhere else in the world. It also has more magicians per square inch than anywhere else in the world. But I have a theory about this. Where there is light, there is magic. And what we're doing here, and what people have been doing since the dawn of time, when the sun sets and the moon rises, people used to gather around the campfire to share stories and to listen to magical tales. Well, the same thing happens every night in Las Vegas and at every theater in the world. Even today, when the sun goes down, people gather where the light is to listen to the storytellers. Where there's light, there is magic. This next piece is inspired by the magic of light, and it's called Illumination. I had a woman down here that looked like a magician with a top hat. I've not prearranged anything, and that's important. I have not, and I want you to just stand right here at the edge of the stage. You don't have to come on stage. You're just going to hold the... Usually I'm much closer to the audience. Okay, you look like... Turn around so that people can see. Applause. Thank you. And you get to watch really closely right there. So this next piece, let's see if we can get a mysterious dusky blue stage like night there, Keith. Let's bring that all the way down and take the lights all the way down. Yeah, that's really good. This piece is called Illumination. Maestro, music. And a little bit lower there. A little bit lower, lower, lower there, yeah. You can bring the volume up all the way. Illumination. This is the rave portion of the show. Great audience, but I've saved the best for last. So let's bring up the lights here a little bit. I want to thank Regis and Keith and everybody back there for being incredible tech crew this week, huh? Yeah. So anyway, thank you. You guys were on so much, and you guys do such a great job, and it's great to be able to work with you again. And I've had so much fun here. And before I go, I just want to say that whenever you're out in Las Vegas, before you come out, you can Google Magic and Mystery School, McBride's Magic and Mystery School. We have free online classes for you. And also, we have a nightclub in Las Vegas called Wonderground, which is all Fire Circle folk running a nightclub with performance art. It's really great. It's called Jeff McBride's Wonderground. You're invited to that. So let's stay in touch. I actually do answer my emails and Facebook stuff. So. Just to tell me you met me at Starwood, and I'll friend you and all of that, and visit my YouTube channels. I'm just curious, how many people have seen my YouTube videos and TV shows? By a round of applause? Okay. Well, if you haven't, there's a lot of stuff that is the much bigger stuff that I can't even get onto the stage that you can see on my YouTube channel. But what I'm known for is sleight of hand magic. And that's always been my passion, and the sleight of hand magic is by far the most difficult form of magic that there is. And just before I do this final piece, I want to say that we're going to be, right after my show, we're going to transition, hopefully very seamlessly, into the procession to the bonfire. So at the end of my show kind of will fold into that. So you don't have to run away right now and miss the best part of the show. I just want to thank Jeff, for inviting me here, and a big shout out to all the Ace folks and all the Chameleons for bringing me back after more than 10 years. Thank you. Hopefully it won't be so long, because Wisteria really rocks. I like you here. It's great. So anyway, this final piece that you're about to see got me into the Guinness Book of World Records for having the fastest hands in the entire world with a pack of playing cards. And this piece I've been practicing every single day of my life for well over 40 years, just for you tonight. So you ready for one more?
Yeah.
One more? Yeah. Okay, let's run that music. Hell yeah. great. And now we're going to turn the festivities over for the bonfire lighting to Ian Corrigan and the rest of the band of Merry Minstrels as they chant and dance their way down to the bonfire. Thank you very much. I'm Jeff McBride. Here you go, Ian.
Hey, thank you very much. He's Jeff McBride.